Hey Route 66 fans, we hope you enjoy this video about Route 66. You can help support these videos by becoming a member of the California Historic Route 66 Association for only $20 a year. Click the link in the description below and don't forget to click the like and subscribe buttons. We appreciate your support.
Just a quick blurb to everybody that we do record these and we do try to get them up on our YouTube channel. So you'll be able to go back and look at this again later, hopefully. A few general housekeeping for those of you who do not know who I am. My name is Scott Piotrowski. I am the president of the California Historic Route 66 Association. Whether you guys like it or not, that's who I am. So, yeah. Always like to introduce a couple of the board members or any of the board members that I see here. So we have with us both Mike and Jessica May are on our board. Jessica is our treasurer in training. And speaking of treasurer, our treasurer Lynn Miller is on as well. And our director of marketing, Terry Stamoulis. And let's see, who else do I see? I see our vice president of the central region, Beth Murray, is on. And I think that's it for the board right now. Unless I'm missing somebody, and if I am, I apologize. So I'm assuming that everybody knows who our wonderful, wonderful presenter is today. And he probably needs no introduction, so I'm not going to. No, just kidding. Our presenter today is Jerry McClanahan. He is a resident of the wonderful state of Oklahoma and the possible state of confusion, I believe, sometimes as well. Right, Jerry?
And confusion, insanity, whatever, you know.
So Jerry is one of the first Route 66 people that I ever actually met. And we won't say how many years ago that was, but Jerry and I think, wow, it was 10, right? Or was it 8? Jerry and I have to tell the one story about Jerry that is one of my fondest Route 66 memories. And that was being in the Cajon Pass with him and John Robinson. And I felt like a kid in a candy store because I was with Jerry, who at the time had published a few things. But the thing that I most remembered at that point was the Here It Is map series with him and Jim Ross. Mm-hmm. And I just felt like a kid in a candy store with my idol, you know, wandering along portions of old Route 66 in the Cajon Pass and exploring and finding new things that I would never have even thought about. And I have to say that moment really solidified where I wanted to be in terms of Route 66. So it's all Jerry's fault that I'm here.
So I remember that day. It was fun. You were enjoying yourself.
I had such a smile on my face.
Yeah, we were out in the boonies hunting up pieces of gravel and asphalt and the old road embankments and culverts.
I just remember standing in the back of the pickup as we're driving along going, oh, over there, over there, over there.
Yeah, I always thought you were like the country dog in the back of the truck barking and sniffing at everything as we drive by, you know.
Gee, thanks, I think.
Yeah, that was a compliment. You were so, having fun. That was good.
So those of you who have been with us before, we've been doing these now for a good 3 years, actually, this month. Our first Zoom was in May of 2020. It was a response to COVID and the pandemic and just a way for us to connect with people along the road and keep interest on Route 66, especially in California. And we started doing it for that reason, but we've just kept going just because it's been such a wonderful way to reach out to people and hear some stories maybe that we haven't heard before and look at some locations and businesses in a new light. So normally what we do is we have a full-on presentation, but we're going to do things a little bit differently this time. We're going to do just the whole thing as a question and answer kind of thing. So if anybody has any questions for Jerry, please go ahead and feel free to put them into the chat as opposed to asking them. And Lynn is going to keep an eye on the chat for us. And we're going to just have a little, start with just a little back and forth with Jerry and I, as soon as I can remember how to get my computer set the way I want it to be. Minor little details here, right? Share that. And then go.
There we go.
Ooh, wait, actually I have to do one other thing first. Hold on, I apologize. I gotta do one other thing real quick. And that is highlight Mr. Jerry McClanahan for everybody.
Yay.
And then I can share the screen like.
I'm out of focus.
That's the story of our life, Jerry. Both of us are always out of focus. Yeah,
that's right. We're moving so fast, we're a blur.
So Jerry, as I mentioned, did the Here It Is Map series with Jim Ross. But the thing that he's probably most known for now is the book that you're looking at here, The EZ66 Guide for Travelers, which is now in its fifth edition. Jerry, why don't you start off a little with just telling us how you got started on Route 66? And just go ahead.
I was born in a log cabin in rural Oklahoma back in 1957. Well, actually, I was born in the Duncan Hospital, but, you know, it's a bit better story. My dad was a poor oil field Okie. My mom was from the cotton patch at Arkansas. So they bounced around between Oklahoma and Arkansas for, you know, a while, you know, trying to make a living. I was born in 57. In 58, we moved to Southern California. My dad got an excellent line of work in the oil field out there. He worked in the production end, you know. He worked for a petroleum company that would farm out to the majors. So he'd work all over Southern California, you know, around L.A. and Newhall and that area. And in 58, we were able to come back from California on Route 66, passing through Oklahoma City on the way to Arkansas to visit grandparents. And almost every year in the 60s, we'd do that trip. Sometimes we'd do it both ways. Sometimes we'd come back like on the southern route, you know. But I'm sitting in the back seat of the car. And, you know, it didn't have video games, didn't have DVDs. So I was looking out the window at all this cool stuff. It was billboards and neon signs and attractions and snake pits. And I wanted to stop at it all. Dad would drive straight through from Southern California. We'd hit 66 at Victorville, through Oklahoma City to Western Arkansas without sleeping most of the time. Well, he did it in like 28 or 29 hours in 1960. And I know because he wrote down in his work log, you know, about that trip. And I'm seeing all this cool stuff and I'm trying to get him to stop. And I would say I have to go to the bathroom and have me the paper cup over the back seat, that type of thing, you know. We did stop at a Stuckey's or two. We stopped at a snake farm once, but mom stayed in the car with the door locked. And during the 60s, 66 was being bypassed by I-40, and it got more boring, and things that I was used to seeing the next year, we wouldn't see them because we would be on the I-40 instead of 66. And that stuff stuck in my head even after we moved to Texas in 1969. And it wasn't until about 1980, I found a book that had photos of a lot of the Route 66 billboards and things I saw. And that reawakened my interest. So my dad and I, we took our father-son Route 66 journey in 1981. We hit 66 at Shamrock, drove all the way out, followed it. We got off at Victorville so we could go visit where we used to live near Cass State. And I tried to take pictures of everything I could see. Dad would get frustrated because there was a lot of dead end roads. There were roads branching off in the desert that I didn't know if that was 66 or not. So that started me looking through the old maps. newspaper articles, aerial images, anything I could find that would show me where the Route 66 had actually ran, because I wanted to photograph it. 83, I did several trips, including 2 weeks from Texas to Santa Monica and back. And then through the rest of the 80s, I was driving it. People ask me how many times, well, I probably should save that for a question, but how many times have you driven Route 66? And I say, I've been doing it since 81, but I've lived in the middle, so I never do it all at once. And I never have taken account, you know. Last year, I drove all of it, both directions, but I need to do it again this year because I turned 66 next month, and I guess I need to drive 66 again, either that or the Lincoln Highway or something like that.
Or both.
Yeah, who knows?
Or you know, the one thing that I kind of want to try one day is, being in LA, I obviously would start at the correct end of the road out here in Los Angeles, where everyone should start.
But which end? Are you going to start at the downtown, the Santa Monica, back to Pasadena, or back to Needles?
if you're gonna do the whole thing, you do the whole thing. So Santa Monica for sure.
Cool.
But I'm thinking that, you know, Jerry, for your 66th birthday, you do all of 66, you do a loop. You do 66, you go up PCH as far as San Francisco, you pick up the Lincoln Highway and take the Lincoln Highway all the way to Illinois,
and it's possible,
then head back on 66 the rest of the way. That's what
possible.
You're going to have to do.
Might and then
just you have,
do it.
And then you have to come back and tell us about the trip. How does that sound?
Sounds all right. We'll see what happens.
So talk a little bit about, and I think I did this pretty well, perfectly. Tell us a little bit about getting started in the preservation movement of Route 66.
Well, you got the art thing up there first, so I guess we'll start with that because that kind of led into it.
Mm-hmm.
Like I say, I had been wanting to photograph Route 66. I was influenced by John Margulies and these other photographers. And since I've been an artist since I was a kid, and since I've got a degree from North Texas State University in painting and drawing, and didn't have any subject I really wanted to paint, I realized, okay, I can do Route 66. And I started doing Route 66 art in the 80s. In the 90s, I started doing it seriously, you know, as much full time as possible. I had done all these photos, taken all this research. It helped me to restore things on paper. The associations began to develop during this time frame, and I was a member of several of them. I would send photos I had taken in the 80s to like Shamrock, Texas. They were going to restore the neon on the U drop in. Well, I had photos taken in 81 and 83 that showed all the old neon, you know, sockets and standouts. And I had the postcards that showed the neon. So I shared that with them. When they restored the Domingo trading post north of Albuquerque, Kaisa Bartuli asked me if I had any interior photos. Well, yeah, in 83, I'd gone up on the mezzanine and shot the whole inside, so I was able to share photos of that with them. And I've been restoring it on paper. I've been working with the Oklahoma Association. I've got their shirt on right here. I'm on the board of the Oklahoma Association. This is a different one. Ask me a question. I run out of steam.
Actually, you know what? Before we get to this one, let me ask you one of the questions that I
sure
have. I think I've asked you before, but I love hearing about Rudy. So tell us a little bit about Rudy.
Okay, Rudy is kind of my mascot alter ego. I created him in 1992. Began using him on a Route 66 coloring book I created in 1992. In 94, he appeared in our Here It Is maps, and he's been on every map since then. He has appeared on nonprofit charity t-shirts to help support like the Huntington's Disease Foundation. He's been on some of the state association things. Rudy's been around. He's been around the block. He's been all over between Chicago and Santa Monica. And I'm working on more things to do with Rudy right now. He was a cartoon in Well, he appeared in a cartoon in the Federation News by, you know, put out by David Knutson. He appeared in Route 66 magazine. And like I said, he just kind of basically my alter ego. Of course, then there's an evil Rudy. I call him Rat Rod Rudy because I think I get sued if I call him Root Fink.
Well, you mentioned David Knutson and the Federation News. Mm-hmm. So let's talk a little bit about your connection with the National Historic Route 66 Federation.
Well, the here it is map series kind of put me on the map, back in 1994. And 2003, I get a call from David. I'd written for his Federation News several articles, and I wrote about the Cajon Pass, our trip, including where you guys went back out and tried to dig up some pavement for me to tell me if it actually went through this section. And he said, Jerry, Route 66 needs a good guidebook. And I said, okay, you know, basically that's it. It's like, hey, kids, let's put on a show, you know. So starting in 2003, I spent the next 2 years almost solely, entirely working on the guide. I flew out to California to meet with David and Mary Lou. She and I came up with the title together. One of us said easy and the other said EZ, like EZ, you know, so that's how we developed it. And decided to use the spiral binding so people could actually use it in a car, even though that kept Barnes and Noble from selling it because they wanted to, you know, to slot it. Mm-hmm. But that was the first edition. We're into the fifth edition. There would have been a fifth edition in 2020 if not for a certain virus that prevented me from doing all my traveling.
Yeah.
So I was really pleased and excited to get the new edition out. Came out in January. I sent him the files in the middle of November. Then they got lost in the mail, so I had to send them again. And then we had to hold the presses because they had reopened part of 66 in California. So at one point, though, you just give up and say, here's the book, and we'll do updates on my website.
Gentlemen, can I cut in for a quick second?
Sure.
No. Scott, David got knocked off of a Zoom. Can you let him back in? Are you in?
I'm
okay.
I'm
just checking. I couldn't see him.
Is David in?
He should be.
Hope so. Hi, David.
I don't have anyone in the waiting room, so that's good.
Okay, because cool. I just coached him on how to get back in. He got knocked off. Just checking. Cool.
Oh, no, he got knocked off.
So, Jerry, talk a little bit about how the guide is set up. And also, you mentioned the website. So talk a little bit about what the website is.
Okay, first I'll mention the website, mcjerry66.com, which is listed in the guide. It's my personal website where I have my artwork, and also I have updates. So anytime I hear about road construction, or a bypass, or a new business, or a business that's closed, I will post updates there. And I also have EZ66 on Facebook where I post quick things like there's going to be a tornado today or something like that, you know. So I try to keep in between printings, in between editions, try to keep where people can actually, because this is a living highway. Mm-hmm. It's changing all the time. They're widening the road out near Luther, Oklahoma now, which kind of changes the old-fashioned feel, but now it'll have proper 3-foot shoulders instead of, like, you know, about this much, you know. Bicyclists will be able to use it and have some degree of safety on those curves and hills. And we love it when people restore something. We love it when people open a new business, and we hate it when something's torn down, you know. It's a process. It's evolving. Yeah, there's David. David and Mary Lou were my really good friends. They started the Federation. They have, you know, David's been my publisher and my friend, like I say, 2003. Pretty good fellow.
Yeah, I agree. Pretty good guy.
Yeah.
I remember when I first met them too. They're just the amount of effort and work that they put in early to preserve the road is definitely a large part of why we're here today. I mean, without the work that was done by you and them and Michael Wallace and
a bunch of his people, book, you know, really launched the Renaissance. That book came about at the right time.
Well, you kind of alluded to this a little bit, and there was a question asked in the chat. So let's talk a little bit about what kinds of changes you've seen. Not just, you know, obviously there's been a lot of changes on the road since you first got involved, and then me as well. But the question specifically in the chat is, what kind of changes have you seen since COVID, and how did that affect the road?
Well, I can offhand think of some places affected. There was a practically brand new old car museum on Route 66 in Baxter Springs, Kansas. I believe it opened in 19 and it closed because of COVID. Our friend in Texola that had the art gallery and a little grill, I'm not sure if she's open yet. I'm trying to think of other ones. I'm sure if I started looking through the Easy Guide, I could figure it out. There wasn't as many as I feared that would have closed directly because of COVID. I know, though, hours have changed because people are having trouble getting employees at the restaurants and motels, you know, things like that. Go ahead.
I was going to say, one of the things that I've seen, and this is probably affecting the metropolitan areas more than anywhere else, but when they did start to have things reopening, there was this push for outdoor dining. Mm-hmm. So one of the main things that I'm seeing is like Colorado Boulevard in Pasadena has lost a lane of traffic because they have more outdoor dining in what used to be roadway.
Right.
That's one of the things that I think is kind of interesting in a lot of ways is just being able to see active businesses in that regard. You know, it brings a much different view of life, I think, in that manner. So
there have been a lot of changes in the last few years. I don't think a lot of them aren't due to COVID, but they just kind of coincided. I know Tulsa has done a similar thing on 11th Street, where instead of having four lanes of traffic, you have two in the middle, and then you have a bike lane and parking along the side. And that seems to be working out well. People can actually pull off and park in front of the businesses and shop there.
Yeah.
And it kind of seems to slow down the traffic as well.
Well, switched over to this map. And Beth asked a question, and I think it's a pretty good one. How do you recommend people handle the two different alignments in Illinois?
Oh my gosh. It depends on your time. If you're typical and you don't have forever to do it, you have to pick one or both. Now, I do have one one recommendation for that section, and I'm going to flip to my page here. You have your route before 1930 that followed Illinois 4. It goes through Carlinville. It's really, really scenic and rural. And you've got all the little dog legs. You got the turkey tracks. Then you have the route that generally follows I-55 straight down to Litchfield. But if you use the Illinois 4 route, you miss Litchfield and Mount Olive, which has got cool things. So in the Easy Guide, I suggest that they use Highway 16 to connect between those two options. They can come down to Carlinville and then jump over 16 to head over to Litchfield. So they do have a choice, a way of kind of zigzagging to get kind of the highlights. Now, when I did the Easy Guide research trip last year, I came up, I was headed eastbound, and I stopped in Carlinville and got my room. I drove all the way to Springfield that evening and back. And then the next morning, I went back down to Staunton and then drove on to Chicago and then covered it back. So I had to do quite a bit of the looping. And it's like the Santa Fe loop. That's almost impossible to do on the same trip. So I give people a choice, try to give them some information, and you got to just decide how much time you have and what your interests are. And do it over two or three trips.
So let me ask you the same question for California. How do you?
Oh my gosh! Like which?
Jerry.
Well, here, okay, you got Glendora up on there. That's mm-hmm. not a far distance. Just do a loop.
Yep.
Just do a loop. But I'll tell you, I spent 4 hours between Pasadena and Sunset Boulevard, driving every alignment and researching and photographing. So it can be quite time consuming.
Same thing. Monrovia is a pretty easy one for the loop as well.
Yeah. Yeah. It's not hard to do those little loops there. And then here's your spaghetti, you know. The main tour is Arroyo Parkway. You told me the secrets about how to drive it years ago. In fact, Scott and I, when I was doing my research, he walked me all around the tunnels, up on the service roads and up the spiral staircase and everything. So that was a grand tour. I like the alternate 66 on Figueroa, Highland Park and all. There's a lot of cool stuff there. I don't mention the Huntington Drive version as much because it seems like there's just not as much of the old flavor on that one.
Yep.
But yeah, I do tell them westbound how to circle back to drive the eastbound tunnels if they want to. So I do recommend the loop for that.
Yeah, that is definitely a unique experience being on the Arroyo Seco Parkway when it's kind of open and has a little bit of flow to it.
Yeah.
That's a very, very interesting drive for so many reasons. So many.
And then the theater district and Broadway downtown, which I got to enjoy because of that conference that you headed. I enjoyed walking around, taking photos. I enjoyed the farmer's market, all the theaters. It's really great. It was pretty exciting. And then you've got Santa Monica Boulevard, which is a lot of traffic. But
I feel like that takes a day in itself from downtown to Santa Monica.
Oh, yeah. And people ask when to go, and it's okay. I don't know. But you've got to do it if you've driven all that way. Of course, you'll notice on this map here, see, I give a lot of options, but options. If too confusing, just use main tour because the box directions are the easiest way. If all you did was turn each page and follow the westbound directions, you could drive all of Route 66 and ignore all the other options and side trips and maps because people look at all that and they think, well, it's too complex. Well, if you take the bite-sized chunk of just either the box directions, then you can add on, you can accessorize. It's interactive. Yeah, you can look at it and say, okay, on this section, I'm just doing the simple directions, but then I'm going to take this option or I'm going to take this side trip. Highlighter and reading ahead is your friend. Because it's hard for me just to eliminate, you know, I can't put everything in there, but it seems like each section has something interesting, you know. It's
true. I mean, everyone who has heard me speak before knows my love for Los Angeles.
Sure.
And there's just so many historic structures in this area. There's so many unique locations and unique businesses, and
yeah.
It's everyone thinks that, oh, there's just nothing there, but it's a treasure trove. I mean, it's, you take all of those businesses and put them into one tiny little section, it's almost overkill in a way.
I actually quite enjoy San Bernardino to Pasadena. And it never bothers me to drive that stretch. There's a lot of cool stuff.
I think Beth would really, really like to have that reiterated again. I know she's really fond of the central area and the San Gabriel Valley.
There's so much history. And I wanted to add some side trips. I wanted to add downtown like San Dimas. It's just a mile south. I like that Ford store. I like their restaurant. I like the yellow painted depot. But that page got too complicated and I had to remove it. I also wanted to put the oldest house over there at Rancho Cucamonga. I had toured that, but some of the side trips like that, just I couldn't cram all the verbiage on the one page and I couldn't spread it out among other pages. So that's always a struggle. I've got to make it easy to look at and read, but I've got to put as much as possible. This is where other books come in handy. If you read Drew Knowles' books or Jim Hinckley's books, if you look at them that explain to you more about the history of these places. They don't guide you to them, but they tell you this is what you want to see, or this is what you don't want to see, depending on your personality.
You know, I think you make a good point there, Jerry, that there's a lot of information available to us. You know, what's out there now is definitely a lot different than it was 20, 25 years ago. And the ability to find all of this information and do all of these side trips and do all these tours, supporting each other, supporting Drew Knoll, supporting Jim Hinckley, Ron Clements with the sports book. You know, there's so many different viewpoints and angles and ideas.
That is the thing about Route 66. It connects so many different interests. You have music, you have sports, you have the Old West, you have just for every type of geekery possible, Route 66 hits some of it, you know.
Oh, yeah. It's the, how do you describe it? It's the...
Well, I describe it as it's like a charm bracelet with all sorts of different charms hanging on it. And they're all on the same bracelet, but they're all different.
Yeah, exactly. It's a unifying force, you know?
And yeah, yeah. It's a thread that connects it all.
It doesn't matter what your interest is, you'll find it. And I think that's one of the things that we've kind of talked about with the California Historic Route 66 Association is, you know, planning an itinerary around whatever your interest is on 66. Mm-hmm. You can find whatever it is that you want. You mentioned the theater district downtown.
Yeah.
All the historic theaters.
Tons of theaters. We have a 1926 theater here that just finished showing Guardians of the Galaxy, you know, so.
And you know, there's places like the Coleman and the Rialto and lot of Rialtos, but I'm specifically thinking Joliet and then downtown.
But LA. I was thinking South Pasadena.
South Pasadena, yes.
Yeah, because I got to go in that before it became a church. After the conference, one of the guys I met there let me and Mariko go in and see it.
That's it's kind of funny that would be the one that I forgot to mention, being that that's the one that's like, what, half a mile from where I live?
Yeah. It's in your backyard syndrome.
Pretty much.
I always ask my foreign visitors why they became interested in Route 66. And it's all these things we've mentioned, the American music, American movies, the American Old West. They want to come and drive through America. And then some of them don't even know about 66 until they start researching. And they say, well, here's a route. Here's a good route that goes by all the stuff they want to see. Grand Canyon, they can take a side trip to Las Vegas. They can, you know.
Yeah.
It's a worldwide phenomenon.
Take a little side trip to your gallery, for example.
That's right. And it is a side trip. I'm like within a block of 66, and it's not a dotted degree turn. It's hard to get people to know exactly where to turn. But my property at the back touches onto the Route 66 right away. And if I was standing there and throw rocks, I could break windshields and cars. So I don't do that. But, you know, that's how close I am. And I bought this property in 2008. I'm still developing the gallery. I'm still working on the house. It's a process. But I've had people from all around the world come by and visit. It's incredible. I've got people from Australia coming about 5 this evening.
Trying to keep an eye on chat. And Terry, I'm going to ask you to unmute and ask that question that you put in there.
That question.
Yes. Hey, Jerry. One of the things that I appreciated, because we just met by phone and this is the first time I'm, you know, getting to see you actually. Nice to meet you. I really do appreciate how you really want to focus on economic development, which my colleagues know I'm passionate about. It's about new businesses and old businesses to let the road thrive. But one of the things I found so interesting was that you mentioned that your art actually helped to trigger your passion for 66 again and to help kind of promote and preserve it. So I thought that might be an interesting thing for you to share.
Well, let me think about this a minute. Excuse me. I have restored things on paper and canvas to how they looked back in the old days. Like I had done in 2003, a painting of the Painted Desert Trading Post out in eastern Arizona. I had photographed it in 91, and it was just almost a bare blank wall. There was only a little of the writing on the front. And I took old photos and I redrew all that writing. Well, come out to let's see, about 2 years ago, I was able to stand on a scaffold around that building and redraw the real lettering on it, because a group of friends had bought the property, formed a nonprofit, raised funds, and actually restored that old trading post. And I'm up there on a scaffold looking at this lettering done by the original guy back in the 40s or 50s. And some of it I can see, some of it I can only see faint traces, but I can see where he drops his E a little bit as he paints it. I can see the little idiosyncrasies. And I tried to duplicate that. Anytime I can supply an old photograph, the Highway Cafe restored their neon sign recently in Vinita, Oklahoma. They did not have a photo of the neon illuminated, but I had eaten there in 1986. So I was able to send them a photo of it, and their neon sign company restored it according to that photo. So I've been lucky to have started this early and have, you know, developed quite a lot of research material. I'm on the preservation committee of the Oklahoma Route 66 Association. And we have done many projects over the years and continue to work towards the centennial.
So I stopped the screen share for a minute, and we're going to put you on the spot a little bit here, Jerry. Scott McCoy asked if you could show us your Rudy character. Do you have anything around you that you can hold up?
Just a second. I don't know if you can see him. I did a self-portrait in the Easy Guide, and he's sitting on my shoulder. See him?
Yeah, it's a little fuzzy, but yes.
Yeah, that's Rudy. And he's been my mascot since 92. I registered him with the U.S. Copyright Office. I've taken a statue of Rudy along Route 66 and photographed him along the way.
That's the only one.
Well, wait a minute. Hang on just a moment. I've got another thing.
That is probably the most well-traveled character along the highway, would be my bet.
Yes, I mentioned my rat rod Rudy guy. Here is something I did recently to those lines. Let's let it stabilize. So he's driving a 57 Chevy in the old Munster Rat Fink style. Can y'all see that? And it's kind of there.
That came out of there. Yeah, there you go.
Yeah, that was fun to do. So I've been developing different images of Rudy. I did him recently as a Jack Kirby style superhero and posted it on Facebook. I don't have that handy. But yeah, Rudy and I go way back, and we're still working on stuff together. He's like I say, he's my alter ego.
Well, hopefully he'll keep you traveling on the road a good amount for time to come. At least for a few more years, which will bring us to the next question.
Yes.
What are your hopes for the centennial?
Well, first off, I hope a lot of people are inspired to drive Route 66 and go to all these businesses and all these museums and all these shops and buy all these maps and apps and books and souvenirs and really support Route 66 so it can have another 100 years. I hope it triggers more development in the years running up to it here. We don't have a lot of time, but I hope I've heard of plans different places have in advance of the centennial. I hope it promotes more interest, more discussion, more expansion, because, okay, we have currently western part of Lincoln County, just across the county line, the Threat service station, which was owned by an African-American family going way back before Route 66. It is being restored. In fact, the Oklahoma Association is having a kind of a work day out there, I think June 11th. We're including more stories like that into the narrative. I did a painting of Graham's Rib Station in Springfield, Missouri for a semi-famous author, T. Lindsey Baker, who does books on gangsters, outlaws, ghost towns. He did a great book on driving Route 66. I mean, eating along Route 66. I restored the Graham's rib station because it was about five blocks north of 66, but it was integrated. The office workers would go. The office workers would eat there too. And it had cabins in the back, which is one of the few places in Springfield that Black families could stay on their trips. So like I say, it's spreading out. All these stories are being incorporated. It's not just my story of sitting in the back seat summer vacation, you know. Of course, my folks are Okies. We were, you know, if you watch Grapes of Wrath, you know what kind of people we were, you know.
Well, I think I would like to add one thing, and hopefully my board will back me on this and agree. But I think one of the things that I really want to see happen after the centennial is that we get a new batch of people interested in the highway, a younger group to come along and keep what we've been working on, keep all that going, keep the preservation hopes alive, keep the businesses alive, bring new businesses in. Because I agree. You mentioned, this is a, you know, it is a living, breathing highway, and we have plenty of room along it for a lot of independently owned businesses to continue.
So. Hey, Scott, that's vital, because I look at like Model T clubs and all the people there are older than I am, and who is going to want their Model Ts later? We can't let Route 66 become an outdated Model T. The moving cars helped a lot. I met so many families after cars that the only reason they were on Route 66 is their kids saw cars. And now these, how long ago was that? You know, how many years ago did cars come out?
Well, that's a good question. Yeah, I don't even remember.
It's been a while, but I think
let me put it like this.
16, 17. Well, these kids 17. Are getting old enough to drive Route 66 now, you know?
That's what I was just going to say. Yeah. They're out there in their car now doing it.
2006. Yes,
thank you. Thank you. Yeah. I'm trying to do some Rudy things, probably a new coloring book, activity thing with Rudy and some games and things. I want some more child interesting things to put out there. And I guess this means we have to kind of go into the helping the electric car people. I know people of my generation will often hate posts about electric cars, but they don't threaten me. I enjoyed driving, was it Mike Mays? Mm-hmm. Tesla? Yeah. I love that thing. I mean, I would get in so much trouble with speeding tickets if I had that little four-door car, you know? You put your foot in it and it puts you back in the seat. Yeah. Well,
I think we would be remiss if we didn't mention Mike and Jessica being involved in EV66?
Route 66 Electric Vehicle Association, and Jessica's the president. We're going to be out there at the end of June for Roadfest, Jerry, so we'll see
you
in person.
I'll probably be there. I might be manning a booth for the association, or I might be out on the road somewhere. I don't know. My birthday is that weekend, so I don't know where I'm going to be.
Big party. You better be there, because there's going to be a big party there for you.
We'll see what happens. I might go hide somewhere.
I was just going to ask if anybody had any additional questions, and boom, there was one popping up in front of me. Do you think you will add the electric vehicle charging areas to the EZ guide?
It's possible. It's possible in the future. I would have to think of a way to do that. It might be just a symbol on a map to show people that there's one there. It's certainly an idea.
And Scott McCoy, I know you're here. The same question was actually posed to you as well. Do you have it in your app? Can't hear you yet, Scott. Nope, I don't think his mic's working today. Okay.
Hey, Mike and Jess May, keep me apprised of information about any charging things along 66 and how they're growing.
Oh, I will.
Yeah,
I don't
because
know if it's feasible to put in your book because it grows so quickly and changes so quickly. There's always a site called PlugShare that keeps up with that.
Yeah.
So
it might be best to mention an app. If it changes a lot, putting it in concrete here could get people in trouble because if it's no longer there.
Yeah.
So I definitely
they don't have a tendency to go away, but they show up a lot more often than like a new gas station does.
Yeah. I want to put the, for sure, a link to a site or something where they can get that information.
Yeah. PlugShare is great for that.
We have a QR code for PlugShare we could share with you.
Cool.
Yeah. Can you hear me now?
Now we can. Yes.
All right. Sorry about that. So many buttons in this place. I just missed one of them this morning. We get this question a lot as well as I'm sure Jerry gets it all the time. And it does. What everybody said, it changes so frequently. We have here in Atlanta, Illinois, they have two new ones. Here in Bloomington, we've got, you know, a couple new ones. And that's all within the last like 2 weeks. So the other apps that keep up with these are probably best. We are in talks with some of those other apps to provide it kind of in a doorway to our app, whether it links to them or it provides it through them. I don't know. Those are different things that we're working with different organizations, but it is very difficult to keep up. And, you know, as Jerry knows, and anybody in this business knows with maps or anything else, you miss one thing and everybody's like, oh, it's you know, you're missing this one. And then you hear about it for the next, you know, year until you get it on there. But it's growing. It's growing very quickly, but we're trying to find a solution for that as well.
Thank you. Appreciate the feedback there. Does anybody else have any further questions for Jerry? We normally try to go only about an hour, so.
Sago-san has one. can you see Mr. Sago's question just a minute ago? I didn't get to read it.
I didn't see it. I missed it. How did I miss it? Oh, there it is.
Let's see.
Are you going to be at your gallery June 14th or 18th?
Well, let me look at my calendar. All right, June 14th.
He's going to stop in and needs a new version, updated version of the Easy Guide.
Definitely.
While Jerry's looking, there's a related question about which is the best way to purchase the Easy Guide?
All right. People sell them online. I know Scott McCoy has been selling them. Spencer Station has been selling them. Rich Henry has been selling them online. People have been putting them on eBay. You can get them straight from my publisher, David Knudsen. And I cannot find my calendar, but I'm going to write down, that's an old calendar. I'm going to write down his question.
Yeah, if I can jump in, the other thing is go to your favorite local mom and pop bookstore. Ask them to order it for you.
Yeah, you can ask them to order it, yes.
You know, see if they can get it for you, because one of the things, if they don't have a lot of information on Route 66, it might trigger them to look at stocking some of the information on Route 66, and we help to elevate and support those mom and pop
stores.
That's
a very good idea. I know the big box store doesn't have it.
The other thing to watch, if you're buying it online and you go, wow, this is a great one, the price is so much cheaper. And then if you look carefully, you'll find out it's the second edition. You want to always buy the most current one, which looks like this on the cover, the fifth edition.
What's really funny is when you see an early edition and they went over $100 for it or something. Yes. And I'm thinking, gosh, man, there's...
You want to know really funny? My book, I saw it on eBay once for like $1,000.
Yeah, but yours is worth it.
I don't know anybody who actually bought it, but
hey, I bought it. $1,000.
For $1,000? I want to do a real quick. This is
Scott. What we can do is we can put the I had put it in all of the promotional information, how to order the book to the Federation. So we can repost that on our Facebook. And by the way, it's great to see so many new faces and names joining us today. That's fantastic. Thank you, Jerry. You connected us to a whole new group, and we hope you'll keep following us.
Sure.
And join our next couple of Zooms, because we have some great programs coming
up. Well, we'll see what happens. Unfortunately, a lot of times on Saturday morning, I am out away from the house. But maybe I can look at it on the phone.
We're hoping.
But, yeah.
we definitely appreciate you taking the time today with us. It's been absolutely wonderful. And like Terry said, thank you to all the new people that we see today that we haven't seen before. I see also a lot of names that are very familiar to us. We've seemed to have gotten a pretty good following of consistent viewers on our presentations and monthly Zooms, and we appreciate all of you that keep coming back as well. For those of you who do not know, I mentioned it a little bit at the beginning, but we have been doing these presentations now monthly since May of 2020. So props to the board who have worked very hard to continue getting presenters. It's not as easy as it seems to keep these going on a monthly basis and have quality presentations and conversations like today's. It's an ongoing effort. And I know that I'm supposed to do this, so I'll put it back
you
up.
Better do it. You better really, do it.
I appreciated your Zoom meeting on the bridges in San Bernardino County, the ones that, you know, east of Amboy. That was a lot of good information. It gets good information out there, guys.
It has been a very, very difficult thing for us to do. I did that wrong, darn it. I apologize. We'll have to live with it like this because it's going to be too hard for me to change it. But we have a few good upcoming presentations. Next month will be Marian Pavel.
Yes.
With the Route 66 Passport and Navigation App. And then, Terry, do you want to say a little bit about the authors panel for July 22nd?
Yes. Actually, we have three great authors. Hold on. I have to look. Just in case I don't mess this up, we're going to have Jim Hankley, Ken Lee, who's a photographer who has taken me almost 3 years to find a photographer who actually will come into our Zoom. And he's just released a really beautiful book on night photography, very heavily focused on Route 66. And Cheryl Jett, who is from, I think, Yeah, she's going to, I'm finalizing her. So we'll have, I think, a really diverse group of panelists talking about the guidebooks and Route 66. I'm real excited about that one. And that is
I'm going to try to listen in on that.
Yeah. And it's a good one for August because the shoulder season is right around the corner in September, October.
Terry.
Oh, sorry. July.
Yep.
July. Sorry, my bad. And in August.
Because
yeah.
Duran Sanchez with the Bureau of Land Management is in August. And for those of you who don't know, the BLM out in the Mojave Desert is one of our longtime partners. We've worked with them a lot in the region out there. They were very instrumental in helping get the National Scenic Byway status from Needles to Barstow. It's been an absolutely wonderful, wonderful partnership for us.
And so Lynn Miller plays a big role in that relationship with the BLM, and she secured Duran for us.
Cool.
So those are our upcoming. Hopefully we'll get to see you guys back next month. And with that, we'll say a big thank you, Jerry.
Your time. My pleasure.
And we'll see everybody next month. Oh, I'm sorry. One last thing. Sorry, Terry. I remembered. If you haven't already, head over to our website, route66ca.org. You can hit the contact button and drop us a line if you have any questions. I do try to monitor those emails as much as I can, but you can also join our association there. There's a join button on our website, and you can help us continue not only this programming, but the preservation work, and stay in touch with what's coming up, including getting ready for the centennial. So head on over to route66ca.org.
Yay.
Yay. Thank you, everybody. Looking forward to seeing you again next month.
Bye. Sego-san, bye-bye. Jerry,
thank you. Have a happy. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye, guys.